Blog Talk Radio.
This land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. Though I am just a man, with the help of God, I know I can be strong.
I wish Israel knew that. I don't think Jews or Israel does know that today. They know that their government is not reliable. Doesn't matter if you're on the right or the left, you are religious in Israel. You know that the prime minister is probably the best you have, and he's horrible. He is not the right person to be leading Israel at this time, because he's way too culpable in the existence of Hamas. He's way too culpable in the removal of the IDF deterrent along the southern Israel border that enabled 10/7 to happen. He was way too slow in his response to what happened on 10/7. And unlike a moral politician, he has not accepted responsibility. Now, I do not criticize him as the progressives across America are doing, where they claim that he is only trying to prolong the war because he wants to stay in office, because that's insane. There's nobody even in Israel, even on the left, that wants to end the war against Hamas until they have achieved what they think is victory. Although I'm here to tell you that is impossible, and I've said it's impossible from the beginning. There were a number of other issues in Israel, more so than ever before in the nation's history. The overwhelming preponderance of Jews are beginning to realize that the Haredim, the ultra-religious practitioners of Judaism, are parasites, that they are a cult, and that they are counterproductive. And that's a good thing. It's a step in the right direction. I think that moderate, thoughtful, non-religious Jews have come to realize that the far left is also a tremendous liability, and that their agenda, as they protest against the government, as they protest to have the last 100 or so hostages, if there's even 50 alive, returned at any cost, the Shabat kind of deal, where you give 1,000 to 1, you end the war, allow Hamas to be victorious, and to save perhaps 40 people, you sacrifice 40,000, assuredly, as I'm speaking to you now. It is insane. It is grossly immoral. And yet that is what they're pleading for, and they want to blame Netanyahu for not giving them what they want, which is suicide. Now, the knowledge that the IDF, while it is fighting bravely, while it is the most disciplined military in the world, can't save Israel. And that realization hopefully will bring more Jews to the realization that as the last bastion of hope for Israel, they need to turn to a much more formidable power, and that would be Yahowah. And they can't go to the left because they are counterproductive. They're pleading against the government. They're pleading against judicial reform. They're pleading against this war. They're pleading in favor of a fake Palestinian state. Are all insane. So on the right and on the left, there is no hope in Israel. And yet Israel is the only hope for humankind. Israel is not just battling for the survival of Israel. They're battling for the survival of Jews. Back in the 1930s and the early 1940s, before there was a sanctuary for Jews, a place that would actually fight to protect Jews, when there was the same kind of upheaval that we're witnessing now, Jews had no place to go. And they were almost annihilated. 6 million of them paid the ultimate price because there was no sanctuary for Jews. There is one today, but if it is lost because Israel continues to make horrendous mistakes and because the world has turned against Israel, then we'll be back to a situation that's far worse than what the world experienced in the 1920s and 1930s and early 1940s. For then, there was one doctrine, one party, one dogma that touched a nerve that was prevalent among most Europeans: rampant anti-Semitism. And this one dogma, which was positioned as the people's religion by Adolf Hitler, managed to turn universities to very hostile places against Jews. They started there, just as it started there in the United States and in Europe. And then it went to their stores so that they couldn't go about their business. And then it went to their homes where they used the IBM punch card system to locate Jews and haul them away to concentration camps. We're not just at the first phase of what happened in Germany, but what's happening on college campuses across the United States and indeed Western Europe is far worse than what the Nazis inspired in Germany in the 1930s. Far more hostile. And it has a much broader backing. We're not dealing with 20 million Germans who happen to be Nazis, but 2 billion people who happen to be Muslims, which is the most deadly and demonic, dehumanizing, anti-Semitic religion ever conceived by Satan and man. And they have leagued with and are being supported by, being encouraged by the left, progressives, who are probably a billion strong worldwide. You have 3 billion people this time, not 30 million. And it isn't isolated to Germany. It's across the world. Israel, unless you wake up and recognize that you've done everything wrong as it relates to what occurred on October 7th, you're not going to exist anymore. Now, the hope is, and the expectation is, that there will be a remnant of Jews who awaken. And they're going to awaken because of what's on the bookshelf at yadayah.com. Go there, please. An Introduction to God, Yada Yahowah, Observations, Coming Home, Babel, Twistianity, Goddamn Religion. It's all there, explaining it all to you so that you might know the truth and so that you might be among that remnant. Some 77,000 is my best estimate of Yehudim and Yisraelites that are going to accompany the return of Yahweh and your Messiah, Dod, your Savior, the very Son of God, on his return on Yom Kippur, in year 6000 Yah, October 2nd at sundown, 6:22 p.m. in Jerusalem, 2033, less than 10 years from now. When October 7th happened, that morning I was translating a prophecy from Yahowah on how he was going to deal with the Palestinians in Gaza. And the answer is he's going to annihilate them. But between now and then, it became eminently aware to me that Israel needed to do the following things. And I begged Israel the evening of October 7th as I took to the air to speak to the people who I serve, who I've devoted my life to for the past almost 23 years, Yisraelites and Yehudim, on behalf of Yahweh your God. That Israel needed to do the following things to survive. And unfortunately, Israel hasn't done any of them. So I'm going to read them, and then we're going to turn to the 11th Mizmowr to talk about what Yahweh has to say about this moment in time. The first of them is to recognize who is at war with you. It's not Hamas. It's not Hezbollah. It's not Iran. It's not Islamic Jihad. It's not Fatah. It's not the PLO. It's the one thing they all have in common. Islam.
Islam.
Yep. Since the morning of October 7th, I have devoted 12 to 14 hours a day, 7 days a week, to a singular cause. And that's rewriting what was originally called Prophet of Doom, which at the time was the most comprehensive, textual, accurate, complete presentation of the Islamic scriptures ever written. It explained why Muslims are trying to annihilate Jews. I set out that morning to rewrite it, knowing that it was one of only three books that I had not rewritten multiple times over the past 22 to 23 years that I have been devoted to the cause of God's people. And oh my, did it need to be rewritten. Not because the things I said about Islam were untrue, they were all accurate. Not as accurate as they are now, but because of the things that I did not know about Yahweh, that I do know now, 30 books later, and a score of years. What was about 700 pages of analysis, followed by a couple of indexes and some preamble material, is now 3,300 pages. The first three volumes of Goddamn Religion have been published at Amazon. They're available for you to buy and to read. They are royalty-free. I'm not trying to make a nickel on you. I would never do that. They're royalty-free at Amazon. There are 825 pages apiece. They're available in Kindle format, paperback, and hardback. They're also available in their entirety free at yadayah.com. Yada means to know. Yah is the familial form of Yahweh's name. You'll find them at the far right side of the bookshelf. Something that David, our webmaster, is currently doing for us is he's going to make a link at the top of the header to each of the family of books so that rather than having to swipe or click multiple times to the end of the far right end of the bookshelf to find Goddamn Religion, you will be able to click directly to it from the top of the header.
Cool.
And the reason that this is important is because while I had originally thought that an introduction to God, particularly the chapter Why You, Why Me, would be the best place for Jews to start, I don't think that's true anymore. It's not a bad place to start. It's a wonderful place to start. Starting the first volume of Yada Yah was a great place to start. Starting the first volume of, Observations is the one wonderful place to start. We began again a few months ago on the first volume of Coming Home. It's a wonderful place to start.
Mm-hmm.
Reading Babel, if you're confused about Judaism, is a wonderful place to start if you're a Jew. Scorchiates, the books written in Babylon, particularly Ezekiel. But now the threat is Islam, not just in Israel, worldwide, against every Jew. And this threat is largely existent because of rabbis. They made it possible. I'll explain that in detail by citing the Islamic Hadith and Quran. Goddamn religion now covers every surah in the Quran, over 90 of them in their entirety. Covers the breadth of the most important hadith collections, particularly Ishaq and Tabari. It puts it all in chronological order from Islamic creation all the way to Muhammad's death. And you will know exactly who your enemy is. And if you say, how can we declare war against a religion of 2 billion people? Now that statement, that question, belies ignorance. You don't have to declare war on them. They declared war on you 1,400 years ago. The largest concentration of Jews, perhaps in the world, in any one place at that time, was in an oasis town called Yathrib. Some 30,000 Jews there. Muhammad annihilated them all. He stole their homes and property. He decapitated the men. He raped the women. And he enslaved the children. Sound familiar? How different is that than what happened on October 7th? That's what happened 1,400 years ago, exactly 1,400 years ago. And from there, after he had killed every Jew in Yathrib, he turned to Kabar. You've heard that name. It's where the phrase Allahu Akbar, Allah is greater than Yahowah, is the intent of the prayer of fear. First used, where Jewish men were not only murdered by Muhammad and his goons, they were tortured. And then after torturing them, Muhammad and his goons raped the women, and they sold the children into slavery. They declared war on you. Your ignorance of that is not helpful. Trying to normalize relationships with Saudi Arabia is not helpful. And in Islam, lying is considered good. All vows, all treaties are renounced between Muslims and non-Muslims. They're used as a stratagem of war. When Muhammad left Petra, which is where the Quran or the Kaaba initially was, in shame, the first act that began the first year of the Islamic era, it does not begin at the first revelation from hell in the cave in Petra. It begins when Muhammad, after the satanic verses and after the wild donk mule ride to Al-Aqsa Mosque, which didn't exist, met with some Arabs from Yathrib, pagans, and they declared war on all humankind, and they've been at it ever since. The Quran is a declaration of war on humanity. All of the surahs revealed in Yathrib demand that Muslims kill. It doesn't just say fight, it says slaughter all non-Muslims, beginning with the Jews. When the Jews are gone, if they got their way, they would kill everyone else. And then when everyone else was dead, they'd kill one another. Islam is a death cult. Quran's not just the worst book ever written. It's toxic. It's demented. It's demonic. It's dehumanizing. It's not my opinion. That's a fact. So Israel, the first thing you need to do is to wake up and recognize the problem is Islam. The Islam of the Quran, the Islam of the Sunnah, the Islam of the Hadith, the Islam of Muhammad, the Islam of Allah. You want to know how he got his name? Read Yahshaya 14. The great prophet tells you all about him. His name is Halal. Allah is Halal. He's the one that sought to be worshipped as if he were a god. That is your enemy. You need to know it. You need to read volumes 1-4 of Goddamn Religion. 1, 2, 3 are already available in their entirety on the site, and by the time you've finished reading those, I will have completed and it will be published volume 4, which will also be 825 pages, which just so happens to be the maximum allowable at Amazon. You need to read it, Israel. You need to know how to survive. You need to know who is trying to kill you and why they are trying to kill you. Because when you do that, you will know that even though you're justified in going after the Hamas terrorist in Gaza, you can't prevail. Bullets and bombs have never stopped a religion. Ever. And you're not going to be the first. You could kill every Hamas fighter, which isn't possible, by the way. But if you did so, it would make no difference whatsoever. None. For every one you killed, you'll manufacture 10 more. And all the while, you'll continue to turn the world against you. Now, I'm not saying that because I have sympathy for the Gazans. I have none. In Gaza, there are two kinds of people. Jihadists and those who support jihadists. That's it. They all want you dead. That's all there is in Gaza. So I do not have a bleeding heart for the Gazians. But you can't prevail with bullets and bombs. You need to fight this war with words and to wield them wisely. And you can't wield them wisely unless you shed your ignorance. My gift to you is Goddamn Religion. And I do not give it to you cheaply. Not only have I devoted the last 6.5 months of my life to rewriting a book that I originally dedicated 4 years of my life to writing, put myself in harm's way by meeting with Al-Qaeda and Islamic Jihad and Hamas 22 years ago. And for doing so, I've received some 10,000 death threats. This does not come cheaply for me to offer you this gift, Israel. So please, don't do what you did to your Messiah. Don't do what you did to the Son of God. Don't do what you did to the Zoroah when he laid down his life as the Passover lamb for you and you spit at him. And he is not Jesus. That's a myth. He's Dode, David, your king, your shepherd, my king, my shepherd. Don't turn down this gift. The second thing that Israel, you have to do, and you're not willing to do it. And I don't know what it's going to take to convince you you need to do this. You need to make saying Palestinian and Palestine illegal in Israel. Illegal. Can't be written in any newspaper, can't be said on any media outlet. There is no such thing as a Palestine. There is no such thing as a Palestinian. But because you don't have the courage to say it, the world is now screaming, free Palestine. From the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. Because you don't have the courage to tell the truth. and you need to do it. Your lives are at stake. This is not a game. You can't send the IDF off and expect that they're going to win this one for you. You've got to have a backbone, Israel. And the second step of that is to recognize there is no such thing as a Palestinian and have the courage to say it. The last Philistine was killed 2,300 years ago. They were bludgeoned by the same Pharaoh of the Exodus, Thutmose the Third, Thutmose the Great. He fought them in Gaza, whooped them. They're the same Palestinians, actually, then, as Philistines that Dode, the great defender of Israel who fought 66 battles and lost none because he knew who to rely upon. He wasn't afraid to say Yahweh's name or to speak out in favor of Yah. And of course, after Dode's victories against the Philistines, the Assyrians came up and they realized that these foreign invaders from Crete were so obnoxious they wouldn't even be decent slaves, so they slaughtered them. Babylonians did the same thing. So did the Greeks. So did the Romans. There are no more Philistines. They're all gone. And even then, there was no place called Philistia. It was Gaza. They had five cities in Gaza. They were obnoxious there. And they were annihilated. They're gone. The only reason that the myth exists is because one of the five worst people who ever lived. Let me put them in order. Paul, the founder of Christianity, is the single worst. Muhammad is the second worst. Akiba is the third worst. Hadrian is next on that list, followed by Hitler. Hadrian decided after he had crucified enough Jews, he had slaughtered enough Jews, he had enslaved enough Jews, that he would rename Jerusalem after himself, build a mighty temple to himself on the Temple Mount, since it had already been, the temple had been torn down. But when he was burning Jews alive with the Torah wrapped around them, soaked in forms of kerosene, he inquired as to who the great enemy of the Jews was. And when some rabbi, that's about the time the first rabbis came to exist, said the Philistines, he decided to rename the province of Yehuda after the Philistines and call it Philistia. That's how the name came into being. It's a misnomer designed to disgrace Jews. To even say it buys into the lie of Hadrian. Don't do it. Don't allow them to create the mythology that they are a displaced people, that Israel is occupying their land, that there is a place called Palestine and they deserve to have it. It's all a lie. The people masquerading under that title are unrelated to the Philistines of old and are unrelated to one another except through incest and all manner of inappropriate breeding, which is why their IQ is so horrendously low and why there are so many birth defects in that part of the world. So you need to eliminate the whole notion of a Philistine. And every time that it comes up, every time someone says, free Palestine, you say, where is it? Why are you pretending to be rallying for the Palestinians when there's never been such a people? And certainly no legacy of them exists today, even if you were to say they were the Philistines of old. And even then, they didn't occupy Israel, ever. They invaded, but they were driven back. Take the upper hand by telling the truth. The next thing Israel had to do was to win the social media war, win the war that's been raging on the internet, and the only way to win that war was to do something that Israel has proven incapable of doing. And that is every atrocity, no matter how horrendous, every burnt body, every rape victim, every abductee, their whole life story needed to be told. Online, first-rate presentation of it. There are pictures of their childhood, pictures of their family, pictures of their life before October 7th, and then every possible picture of what happened to them when these savages attacked them and raped them and tortured them and mutilated them. It all has to be shown. And you say, it's too much trauma. Well, how do you like the trauma that's happening to you now? If you don't do that, you'll lose the social media war. And the social media war is more important than the one of bullets and bombs. You have to make the truth undeniable. It's the reason why Goddamn Religion is now 3,300 pages. The truth is undeniable. I left no stone unturned or unthrown. And you need to do the same thing. Every aspect of that day, everything that happened, every life that was damaged, injured, abducted, mutilated, raped, has to be told. And it all has to be a government site that is beautifully presented. One of the things I admire about the IDF is they're honest. They have credibility. They'll tell on themselves when they make a mistake, and they've made plenty. Not nearly as many as any other army in the world. They're more disciplined than any other. But they'll tell the truth. An IDF site that shows it all. If you think that's cruel to the survivors, think what's going to happen if you don't. See, October 7th was a mosquito bite compared to what's going to happen. I predicted October 7th a year before it occurred. I didn't just predict it quietly. I predicted it audibly. I did a radio show like this one where you can listen to the archive on it. I also wrote it into a book that I published, has a copyright date, a year ago. Mm-hmm. And the moment it happened, I predicted something else, and I'm going to tell you it is going to assuredly occur. What happened on October 7th is going to be 1/100th of what will happen over the next 6 or 7 years. And that is that there will be 100 times more missiles, rockets, and drones fired at Israel, 100 times. There'll be 100 jihadists for every one that invaded Israel on October 7th. That's what's going to happen. And the IDF can't stop it. The IDF is beautifully designed to go to war with Jordan or with Syria. Beautifully designed, probably, well, it doesn't really have all the equipment necessary to effectively fight Iraq. And Iran, there's too many of them, and you have to fly over hostile territory, and you don't have sufficient refueling aircraft or all the right kind of munitions. But you know how to fight Egypt. You know how to fight Jordan. You know how to fight in Lebanon. You can't deal with 250,000 jihadists. They will take over all northern and southern and eastern settlements, communities, towns in Israel, and they will abduct hostages, and they will perpetrate heinous crimes where Israel will be in a position where there's no options. And that's what's going to happen. And there's nothing you can do to stop it other than you can be prepared yourself, and you can make it more difficult by following the advice of the three things that I've already encouraged. I predicted that you were going to invade Gaza before you did it, but I also said that it was going to be a counterproductive mode, that you were going to make a bad situation worse. And you are. That's just the reality. There is no way to prevail. It's not going to happen. And what happens afterward? At some point you have to pull out, the terrorists will all return. It's just the reality of it. That's the nature of Islam. So there's where you find yourself, and there's only one hope, and his name happens to be Yahowah, a God whose name you don't even want to say, and yet his name is in your prime minister's name. Netanyahu means Yahweh's gift.
Mm-hmm.
And yet you won't say it otherwise. You don't know what his seven invitations represent. You don't even know the terms and conditions of the covenant. And it was for you. You don't even know that you, as Yahudim, Jews, were named after Yah. It means beloved of Yah. Yahudim. You've got to begin by knowing, saying, sharing, and being proud of, relying upon Yahweh's name. Without that, there is no second step. There is no hope. I would encourage you to read the books of Yahweh so you know what the five conditions are of the covenant and you can be protected by Yahweh. I would encourage you to read the books of Yahweh so you might understand what the seven Moed Mikre are, because now you think you're celebrating the Passover holiday, and I'm here to tell you there is no Passover holiday. It's Chag Matzah, the very thing that you've forgotten. Chag Matzah incorporates Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim. You need to understand why. It's Chag Matzah, of which Pesach and Bikurim are part. You need to understand what those seven Moed Mikre are and why Yom Kippurim is your final and last hope. All of that's laid out for you at yadayah.com. So this is where you are, Israel. And it is why the world has erupted against you. And I know that there are lots of members of the covenant family who are anxious about what they're seeing around the world. I'm not so much, and I'm going to tell you why. And there are two reasons. One is that if you were to watch the news and listen to the vile voices of progressives and Muslims and college campuses and around the world screaming out to eliminate Israel and to create a Fakistanian state, as if Fakistan could ever be free when Islam means submission and all Muslims are slaves to Allah. There is no free will in Islam. The whole thing's a lie. That as you see these things and you recognize how vile Islam is, how lost progressives are, and how the world has erupted to become overwhelmingly anti-Semitic, and how it's particularly bad among the youth who have been indoctrinated far more than anyone else because progressives dominate social media, academia, the mainstream media, and much of politics now. Because of all of that, there is only one hope for you, and that is Yahweh. And in the midst of the world screaming out against you, what I have decided to do is to tune most of it out. Why? I don't need any more motivation. I don't need to hate Islam or despise progressives any more than I already do. I don't need to be aggravated because I have a job to do. So do you, Israel. My job is to finish goddamn religion and then rewrite Questioning Paul as Twistianity and then finish Coming Home 3, which is a review of Dode's Mizmowr Psalms. I've got a job to do. I can't be distracted by watching this horror show play out as zombies parade around America's universities. My alma mater is in the top five worst in the world today, University of Southern California. So I would advise for the Covenant family, stop watching it.
Yep.
More than any time in your life, prepare yourself to be of value. Read Goddamn Religion. Read Coming Home. Read An Introduction to God. Read Babel. Read Observations. Read yada yada. You might say, I've done it. Read it again. Come to know that material and be prepared to wield it in favor of Israel. That's what you can do. And now that Goddamn Religion is nearly complete, you can help us make Israel aware of these books. Please. That's what we encourage. That be the best use of your time. The second reason is that I realize, and I've come to realize this for a long time, and it's obvious when you read the Torah and Prophets. Israel, you're really a tough brood. I mean, you didn't even get to the Gulf of Aqaba and Nuweiba Beach crossing before you were belly aching and wanting to go back and be slaves against the Pharaoh and Mitzrayim. You were already cussing Moshe, the liberator, who came to rescue you, and you hadn't even crossed the Red Sea. In fact, Moshe is trying to inspire you, and Yahweh says, why are you talking to them? That's a waste of time. Lift your staff, part the sea, and go across. Jews, you're irascible. You've done everything you can to thumb your nose and spit in the face of God.
It's true.
It's time you stop. Time you stop. Seriously. And the most religious of you are the worst of it. And the most political of you are the second worst of you. And those in the middle, there's hope for you. But you got a lot to unlearn. So that's where you are. Now I'd like to share some insights from the 11th Mizmowr. We'll return to the 4th Mizmowr this time next week. I'm doing the 11th Mizmowr because my wife came in about 5 minutes before showtime this evening and said, I want you to start with the 4th Mizmowr. And when it comes to doing what your wife requests, Yahweh only has one example, and that is when Abraham wanted Ishmael to be able to hang around and be part of the covenant, and Sarah knew better and said, send that boy and his mother away, they're trouble. What did Yahweh tell Abraham to do?
Listen to your wife.
Listen to your wife. To the everlasting and majestic guide of Dote, the beloved. The introduction to the Mizmowr begins with Yahweh. I find someone I can trust to keep me safe. So why would you say of my soul, flee to your mountain like a bird? It's actually Mizmowr 11, 1, the lyrics to be sung. All right, so we begin with Dode introducing himself as the one who wrote this song. He is your Messiah. He is the Son of God. He is also the Zeruah, the Passover lamb. He's the most important person in Yahweh's story, in the history of humankind. And he is saying here that the everlasting guide is Yahweh. I would recommend that you accept his perspective. He says, with Yahweh, I find someone I can trust to keep me safe. Kashash, I am comfortable, restful, reliant, at peace, protected, in harmony, having properly placed my confidence. Does that sound good, Israel? No matter where you are, college campuses, whether you have a store that's identified with your ethnicity somewhere in Europe or the United States, whether you're in Israel, you're surrounded by 2 billion people that hate you and want you annihilated. Would you like to be like Dodd and recognize that Yahweh is someone you can trust? So why would you ask, he says, of my soul, flee, put her away to your mountain like a bird? Religious leaders would have Dodd all but disappear. You know, Paul wrote, he's in his grave rotting, so all of the promises regarding him must be to his myth, Iusu Christu. No. Dodd's not in his grave rotting. He's already been here twice before, and he's going to return a third time. For them, Dodd's life is little more than the aimless pursuit of personal grievances, his words lamentable, his attitude that of an incurable complainer. But most of all, they are bothered by the fact that God said of him and did through him everything they have sought to attribute to themselves or to others. Akiba, he created Judaism based upon a false Messiah because he didn't recognize that Dodd was your Messiah and that he had come in your 4,000 Yah to serve as the Passover lamb. And yet Judaism was started and the diaspora occurred because the father of Judaism, Akiba, promoted a false Messiah. Why would you trust him on anything else?
Good point.
Christianity, of course, is based entirely on a false Messiah, when the real one is the most extraordinary person in human history. When the real one not only wrote all of the Mizmowr and most of the Mashal Proverbs, but he's the most mentioned man in God's story. Second only to God's name, Dodd's name, 1,100 times. His name is mentioned more than Moshe's, because he's the man. He is the exemplar of Yisrael. He is the exemplar of the covenant. And yet, religious Jews are waiting for an unnamed Messiah to come and save them. It's Dodd who's returning. Embrace him. The easiest way to simulate this flight of fancy was to take that which was redeeming from Dodd and give what God bestowed on him to another, all of his accolades, all of his titles. In so doing, at least in their eyes, his life became irrelevant, as did his kingdom, his titles, his people, his purpose, his prophecies, and his songs, even his relationship with Yahweh as the Son of God. You know, he's called the Son of God three times. 89th Mizmor is the greatest song ever written of any individual. It's the song of Dodd. Yahweh says, I'm his father, he's my son. And I think one of the most important prophecies ever written, 2 Samuel 7, Yahweh announces, he is my son, I am his father. 2 Mizmor, same thing. I am his father, he is my son. If you don't like the fact that God has a son, then you don't much like the Torah, prophets, and Psalms. When that Yeshayah 9, which was absconded by Christianity, doesn't speak of the misnomer Iusu Christu, Jesus Christ, speaks of Dodd. His name is even mentioned in the midst of it. He is the Son who was given to us. He is the great Gabor. It's a shame that Israel has distanced himself from the Son of God, the Messiah, their Savior. And don't pretend that you're parading around under the Star of David. David didn't have a star. Bar Kokhba was the star. You've just taken the symbol and name of your false Messiah and applied it to the real one. That's stupid. You want to have a symbol, Israel. Make it the 7-candle menorah. Trash the 9-candle menorah. It's a worthless piece of crap. The menorah is your symbol. And when you speak of Torah, don't include the rabbinical writings of the Talmud. The Torah is Yahweh's. It was scribed by Moshe. Full stop. There's nothing more to it. What had been written about Dode was spun in a centrifuge of replacement theology. They took the unrecognizable result and applied it to themselves, to their expectations, and to their incarnation of their own salvation. In this regard, Dode was observant, but he was not the least bit amused. He put us all on notice. This is brilliantly written, and it is vividly depicted. Indeed, behold, those guilty of vexing religious malfeasance, that would be the rabbis of Judaism. That would be all the pastors and priests and popes of Christianity and Roman Catholicism, and most especially, that would be all Muslims. Those guilty of vexing religious malfeasance, rasha, those who are wrong, evil, and hostile to God, the wicked and condemned for lack of ethics, the culpable and horrible frauds perpetrating massive crimes, have bent the bow, the weapons which project their deadly influence and power. They have fashioned and aimed their arrows, the missiles, upon the string to shoot through the darkness and shadows at those who are straightforward and correct in their thinking and judgment. Now, I only wish that there were more targets, because there aren't a lot of people out there today who are straightforward and correct in their thinking and judgment. But the invitation, Yashar Leb, is open to everyone. So this is prophetically addressing the times, not only when Imperial Rome and the Roman Catholic Church and the Holy Roman Empire and all that would grow out of this beast, including Orthodox and Protestant Christianity, European kingdoms and the Third Reich, bent their bow of religious malfeasance and pointed their arrows directly at Yahweh's people, Yehudim, Jews. It is also when 1,400 years ago, Muslims bent their bows and raised their swords against the necks of every Jew in Arabia perpetrating genocide. And they're still doing it today. But with their oppressive religious cult, rabbis are the greatest threat of all to Jews. They need to be exposed. They need to be condemned. You need to walk away from them and disassociate from them, Israel. Now, the following statement is a rhetorical question. Dode is asking us if we know the most appropriate way to respond to what Paul and his Roman Catholic Church have done to demean and replace Yahweh, his Torah, and covenant, as well as what Muhammad and Allah have done. Because the number one theme throughout the Quran, besides Allah's fixation on torturing everyone, is that his Quran confirms the Torah when it is the antithesis of it. Indeed, when the most basic principles are torn down, what should those who are right do? Well, this is actually the line before the one my wife asked me to quote for this show, but it's the reason why I decided to tell you share the whole Mizmowr. Because right now, the basic principles, the very foundation, the essential elements, that which frames and defines the very issues of life versus death, right versus wrong, truth versus deceit, are being broken apart, dismantled, and damaged, demolished, and destroyed. That's the nature of progressive ideology. The nature of the religion of Islam. What should those who are right do? Tsadyq, ma, pa'al. What should be accomplished and be done by those who are correct? And not enough of you are correct, Israel. Please read An Introduction to God. Please read Yada Yahowah. Please read Observations. Please read Coming Home. Please read Goddamn Religion. Shed your ignorance. Become right. Not only with God, but with the truth. What should those who are right do? What should be accomplished to be prepared, to be engaged in what is upright, in accord with the standard, be vindicated? Well, don't know the answer, which is why he was asking the question. Though it's the most brilliant person who ever lived, I can assure you he did not ask this question seeking the answer. He was begging the answer. It's called a rhetorical question. Now, we know it too, because we've read what Yahweh inspired him to compose. And having studied his response, it should reflect our own. And in this regard, the Messiah and Son of God, our Zeruah, the Passover Lamb, is blatantly and boldly, confrontationally prepared, willing, and ready to expose and condemn what is wrong, Russia with the world, with Islam, Christianity, Judaism, and liberal progressive politics. Let's be clear. The most basic principles of the Torah have been assailed and dismantled by Christianity, progressives, and by Muslims. This began with God's name. The Christian God would not be known as Yahweh. The Islamic God would not be known as Yahweh. Nor would the object of worship of progressives. Yahweh's teaching and guidance would be mischaracterized as a laborious list of arcane laws which were no longer relevant and could neither be obeyed nor could they save. And I'm going to tell you what rabbis have done to corrupt these, to create the laws of Judaism, is enough to make you want to vomit. They are arcane. They're a waste of time. They're counterproductive. So is Sharia law and Islam. So are all of Allah's edicts. So is everything that progressives would impose on the world. Yahweh's covenant was replaced with a different one, whether it be the Quran, or the Christian New Testament, completely detached from Yahweh's instruction. The same thing is true with Judaism, with their Talmud. The conditions and benefits that Yahweh was offering to be part of his covenant family were forgotten. The purpose of each of the seven Moed Mikre essentially annulled by religious mandates. The invitations to be called out and meet with God would suffer a similar fate, preceded by a Babylonian holiday, whether it be Christmas and Easter or Purim and Rosh Hashanah. Yeah, the book of Esther with its fabled imaginary history and with a pretend Jew married a unking of Persia to spare the annihilation of Jews. It's a fairy tale. And so is Purim. Maccabees, as John Maccabee decided that he wanted to oppose the Lowy Cohen and their claim to the priesthood because there was money and power in that. And then he draped himself as being anti-Greek influence when it was an Israeli civil war. And created Hanukkah and your nine candle menorah. Don't fall for it. It's all a bunch of lies. Yahweh's story is consistent. It's straightforward. And he provided right in the midst of his Torah, the Bodim 18, two things that are essential for you. One is the prophecy that is so often quoted in the Bodim Deuteronomy 18 that speaks of the one who will come after Moshe, that is like Moshe, that is from your people. He's Dod. David, your king, your savior, the son of God, your Messiah. But the second half of Devarim 18 is the test that you can apply to anyone, anywhere, any book, including those that are now folded into what's called the Bible. Many of those, even in the Old Testament, Hebrew, don't belong. Jonah doesn't pass the test. Ezekiel fails it in every possible way. So does most of Daniel. So does Ecclesiastes. So does the Song of Solomon. So does Esther. Many of them failed that test. God gave you the test and said, this is the criterion. Use it. Rabbis wanted to use their own. So they've ignored it. We haven't. You need to know what you can trust and what you have to discard if you're going to be a useful witness at this time. Dod, Yahweh's beloved son, his chosen one, his branch, his protective shepherd, set apart one, anointed Messiah, sacrificial lamb, and eternal king, would be mischaracterized to either make Jesus or Bar Kokhba appear credible. Even then, after affording their savior either a Greek name or the name of a warlord, Christians and the practitioners of Judaism deprived Dod of his role as the Passover lamb. There isn't one Jew in a million that recognizes that Dod is the Passover lamb, that recognizes that Dod is your returning Messiah, the King of Kings, or that recognizes that Dod is the Son of God. The chosen people would be condemned as inferior by the Romans, by the Roman Catholics, by the Gentile Church, and of course by Islam, where I see so many quotations. So, yeah, can you believe that in some national radio they said that Jews were the descendants of apes and pigs? Yeah, because the Quran says so. That's what the Quran says. It says, you know, that Muslims are ordered to kill Jews. Yes, they are. Can't pretend the Quran doesn't exist. It guides the beliefs and actions of 2 billion people. And it is a declaration of war against all humankind, starting with Jews. Allah wanted Muslims to kill every one of you. So welcome to the here and now. This Mizmowr song has been assailing what we're witnessing. Ignoring the obvious that present-day Israel is located within the boundaries that God depicted, that the population is comprised of Yehudim Jews and their official language is Hebrew, and that there are countless prophetic declarations depicting Yahweh's return to Yisrael on behalf of Yisraelites. The Bible Society justified their conspiratorial animosity and rancid racism by falsely claiming the ancient Yisraelites are not linked in any substantial or material way to the contemporary modern state of Israel. The biblical narrative of Israel has almost nothing to do with contemporary Israel other than the international manipulation of sacred text to justify a political project. And of course, in Islam, it's far worse. When liars lie, especially religious narcissists and self-aggrandizing psychopaths, they almost always project their own faults on those they oppose. That is precisely what is occurring around the world. At the same time, a fakistinian Lutheran pastor by the name of Rahib chimed in. It wasn't the Lord God who promised Israel the land. It was the Lord Balfour. Now that's, of course, only partial true. It was Yahowah, not the Lord God, who promised the land of Israel to Yehudim and to Israelites.
Mm-hmm.
Balfour also promised it, but the world had a conniption fit and didn't allow it. And as a result of that, the Holocaust occurred. There is a myth today that Jesus was a Middle Eastern Palestinian Jew. Talk about stupid. That's akin to claiming that the camel is the result of mating an extinct ass with a lion. Well, I can't speak for your Lord. Yahweh spoke of Israel, Zion, and Jerusalem over 3,000 times in his Torah, promising to return to this very place on behalf of his people, who are named Israel, those who engage and endure with God, and Yahudim, the beloved of Yah. Unfortunately, based upon what Dod realized in this Mizmowr, those of us who have come to love what Yahweh adores will not have to endure the putrid presence or jaundrous verbiage of those who oppose Yehudim or Yisrael much longer. Their term is nearly over. Within 10 years, they will all be gone. Life is about exclusion and inclusion. We are each afforded the opportunity to choose between God and man. Will you exclude yourself from religion, politics, militarism, and conspiracy, and include yourself among those who are in the covenant? Relationship or religion? Truth or deceit? Life or death? Long ago, some 14 billion years looking back from our relative perspective and our position in the universe, 6 days from God's, Yahweh made a decision he would never change. Since he created the universe, conceived life, authored his Torah, offered his covenant to become part of his family, anything our Heavenly Father could do with us or through us, he would not do alone. He has positioned and empowered us to expose and condemn those who would do that which he has warned against. Whether or not we engage as he intended is up to us, but be aware. Even though Yah is leaving this up to us, he is aware of our choices in this regard. This is what my wife wanted me to read to you tonight. Yahweh is in his set-apart sanctuary. Yahweh's seat of honor is in the heavens. He uses his faculty of sight to perceive what can be observed regarding the agreement. His gaze, like a beam of light, assesses the children of man. You know, we don't have to watch everything horrific that's happening around the world. We can instead focus on the Torah, Nabi wa Mizmowr, Yahweh's teaching, his prophetic utterances, and the lyrics to Dod's songs. We can listen to God. We can observe what he has to say. We can be prepared to live with him than to defend God's people. God knows exactly what's occurring. He is not going to allow Israel to be destroyed, although most of it will be. His only promise is to save a remnant. And the remnant that he saves will have chosen to be there. God does not work against free will. He is lifting his staff and parting the sea and offering you the opportunity to go across. Whether you do so or not is up to you. He's not going to beg you. For most of the past 3,000 years, Yahowah has been hands-off, allowing man to do as he pleased. Certainly, for the last 2,450 years since the last of the prophets, Malachi, spoke to us, God has had nothing to say because he said everything that we needed to know. That is why the books of Yada Yah exist, is to share what God has already told us about yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And he intervened to provide this prophetic testimony through prophets such as Yashayah, Yirmiyah, Zechariah, Hosha, and Malachi. And more importantly, through Dod, and prior to him, through Moshe. But he has been silent ever since. Why? Because there was no one for him to communicate through. After Malachi to today, there hasn't been a single Yehudim through whom Yahweh could communicate as if they were serving as a prophet. Not one. That's your fault, Israel. As I said, you turned up your nose, bit in God's face. You are still that belligerent, antagonistic, embittered group that is on Nuweiba Beach saying, I want to go back to the Egyptians and cursing Moshe. You're still the embittered clan at the waters of Meribah. It's time that you change all of that. Because for the past 2,500 years, there hasn't been a single one of you through whom God could communicate. Why do you think I got this job? I got it by default. I'd love to think that something that I offered God that he thought, you know, would be workable, usable, that just like he looked at Dod and said, I choose him for reasons that you humans don't understand. It's not the same way that you go about choosing people. I have a whole different criterion. And while I am no Dod, I can tell you that I might be the person whose attributes are closer to him than anybody else alive today. That might make me 1/1,000,000,000th of Dod, but it's good enough for Yahweh to work with. And so, you know, I might think, hey, you know, I have something to offer. That's why I got chosen, but that's not really true. I got chosen because you wouldn't allow him to choose you. That's why he has been silent. He's not silent anymore. He consented to have his beloved son, Dod, fulfill his obligation to serve as the Passover lamb, giving up his Bashar corporal body, and to have his soul, Nefesh, carry the guilt of every covenant member into Sheol to deposit it there, never to be seen again on unyeasted bread, so that he could be the first of the firstborn children of Bukurim, and then be empowered and enlightened and enriched tenfold on Shavuah. And he has intervened through his Malach spiritual representatives to protect those who are about his business. And he has assigned the seven spirits of Yahowah to inspire what you're listening to this evening, what you will find on the bookshelf of Yada Yah. That's it. Nothing more. And it is because he wanted it to be this way. Yes. He wanted it to be this way. You see, and that's not what I wrote when I wrote this chapter some time ago. There was an episode on Mount Towrah, on the base of Mount Towrah, where Yahowah said to Moshe, you know, that I've given you a lot of responsibility. I'm going to do what I think is right. And I want you to call all of Israel together. And I'm going to come down off of this mountain, and I'm going to speak directly to all Israel in your presence and theirs. And the reason for doing that is I want everyone to know that it is I, Yahowah, who is inspiring this Torah and is inspiring you and who is speaking through you. And so Yahweh did as he said he would. And what did Israel do? No!
Scared?
Don't do that anymore!
No way.
We never want to hear your voice. Get away from here. Speak through Moshe if you must. Yeah, you said that, Israel. You really did. I knew what Yahweh's response was. I was upset. He didn't say, how dare you? You know, Allah would have had a conniption fit and threatened to punish Jews 1,000 ways. That's not Yahweh's response. He says, they're right. I'm good with that. You know why Yahweh was good with that? Who wants to speak to a bunch of embittered children? Who wants to be in their presence? You're a bunch of belligerent, embittered children. You don't need to be. You shouldn't be. You don't have to be, but you are. And Moshe, oh, Moshe, what an example. A man of great courage, wisdom, of empathy, devoted, articulate. Yeah, I know. He said his tongue was slow. I've heard his speeches in Devarim. He was articulate. He was a great writer and a great orator. When you read Bereshith and Shemot, and then you read Kara, the first three books of the Torah, and then listen to how in Devarim Moshe encapsulated all of that, such that it was pertinent to the lives of God's people, not only then, but forevermore, tells you, this man was extraordinary. He had many of the same characteristics of Dode. And so Yahweh said, yay! Can't be any better than this. I love communicating through and working with Moshe. He's one of the two most exemplary people in human history. And I don't have to put up with these embittered children, and yet I get to communicate my message to them. Yahweh was thrilled. And it's what he's doing today. It is what he is doing today. I may not be apprised, but by comparison to Israel, Yahweh finds my attitude towards him delightful. That may not be saying much, but it's good enough. And that's why I'm speaking to you tonight. That's why Yahweh is not speaking directly to you. Nonetheless, he wants you to come home. And he needs you to come home now. Why? Because he's made a promise. His promise is that he is returning with his beloved son, with the Passover lamb, with your Savior, with your Messiah, and your King. And he's doing so at 6:22 p.m. October 2nd, sundown in Jerusalem, in year 6000 Yah, October 2nd, 2033. And he is expecting a minimum of 77,000 reconciled and joyous Israelites and Yehudim there to greet him. on the ultimate family reunion on Yom Kippur, on the Day of Reconciliations. And that is going to occur. And the question is, will you be among those who are there? Should that not happen? And understand, Judaism is doing its best to preclude it from happening. That is, the primary purpose of Islam and the Quran is to preclude it from happening. Why do you think the ultimate enemy of Islam is the kafar? What does kafar mean? It doesn't mean disbeliever. It doesn't mean infidel. It means reconciled. Those who are reconciled with Yahweh are the ones who will thwart the great day of Satan. Because with 77,000 Israelites and Yehudim there to greet Yahweh when he returns, reconciled into the relationship, Satan's time is over. It's his day of doom. And so, Yisrael, you need to know who your Passover lamb is. You need to understand what God has accomplished through the Moed Mikre, what each of the seven represent, what the conditions of the covenant are to accept and use his name. It's not hard to pronounce. You can say Torah, right? You can say Yisrael, right? You can say Shalom, correct? You know, Hayah means to exist, right? So if you can say Hayah, if you can say Torah, if you can say Shalom, you can pronounce Yahweh's name. Three letters, one repeated. They're all vowels. It's not hard. It's all laid out there for you. Heck, I figured it out. Why not you? Yahweh looked for someone who was willing, but he only found one 22 years ago, Monteruah. And I wasn't even all that willing. I said, you want me to do what? Yeah, his first request was to expose and condemn Islam. Thank God I did. I only wish I had rewritten the book earlier as Goddamn Religion, but better late than never. And I don't think if I had tried to rewrite it, I could have done what I've done now. There's so much to learn. So much to know. So much
good.
Oh, so much courage that you and conviction that you develop over the years by coming to know and work with Yahweh, and so many insights that help you understand the very motivation of the Quran and Islam. And so it's the timing is indeed perfect. I told Yahweh at the time, if you really want me to do this, then we're going to have to cut a deal. I said, sure. What do you want? He's pretty smart, right? He can see the future, so he knew what I was going to say. I want the following three things. I don't know squat about Islam. If we're going to do this, it's your responsibility to teach me what I need to know. We're going to work at this as a team. Number two, Muslims have killed everyone who has attempted to do what you're asking me to do. I know, if you are who you say you are and I go about doing this, I have a hunch that, you know, you're going to make certain that we get the job done. But nonetheless, I want a promise from you to protect my home and my family and everyone surrounding me so I can focus on this job. Okay, you said, what is your third? I said, it's your job to promote it. That's the one skill set I possess from my business acumen. I'll do it. I'll write it. I'll make myself available to speak about it. But you must promote it. And he said, reach into your pocket. I did. It was a copy of the 91st Mizmowr. And guess what it says? That God would do all of those things. And even more. And that's why I'm here. That's why I can expose and condemn Islam so bluntly on behalf of Israel and not have to duck. Yahowah examines the genuineness of those who are upright and correct. But the deceitful one who is wrong and religious, and the one who is found is fond of violence, he hates his soul. So I have to apologize to my wife. This is the passage she wanted me to read to you, not the previous one. Yahowah wanted you to hear it all. Let me repeat this. Yahowah, God's one and only name, pronounced Yahowah, based upon Haya, to exist, examines the genuineness, observes, closely examining and carefully considering, even testing, the reaction of the Tsadyq, of those who are upright, correct, right, in accord with the standard, and vindicated. People have this terrible myth about the religious God that you're supposed to be good, supposed to make donations. God doesn't give a crap if you're good or not. I mean, can you imagine how many people were more good than Dode? Shaul, King Saul, he was the goodest of the good. And he was demon-possessed by the end. God found him so useless. Doesn't do you any good. Being right is all that matters. You need to be right about God. To be right about what Yahowah is offering and expecting in return. Why the 30 books sit on the bookshelf of yadayah.com. They're all free for you. There is no donate to us button. There is no club you can join. There is nothing whatsoever you can do for me. Nothing. I will ask nothing of you. Everything that we have to offer is free. It is for your benefit. Yahowah examines the genuineness of those who are right. But the deceitful one, who is wrong, who is religious, rasha, fraudulent, wicked, evil, guilty, leading others astray, and the one who is fond of Hamas. Yes, Hamas is indeed mentioned in the Torah and prophets and in this psalm. Hamas. It means violence. It means being wrong, being destructive. Hamas is about terrorism, about maiming without moral restraint, about plundering and looting others. We're about to end the broadcast portion of our program. Those who are listening on their phones will be able to hear us speak for a while longer. We're going to go through a little more of the psalm before we conclude our program. It'll be part of the recorded archive. God says he hates the soul of those who are Hamas, of those who are Russia. Yes, God hates. And so should we. God damn religion. Title of what will be a 5 series of books.
Mm-hmm.
It is a sentence. God separates from. God forsakes. God damns religion. God hates religion. All of them. Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and progressivism. Hates them all. Why? Because they're wrong. Because they're deceitful. Because they're rasha, fraudulent, and prone to violence. And you might say, well, how are the progressives? You can't say that they're violent. What is the extrapolation of super liberalism? Communism, is it not?
Yeah.
How many people died at the hands of the communists, particularly Lenin and Stalin and Mao? 100 million?
Yeah, at least.
They killed twice as many as died as a result of Hitler. So don't tell me that progressives aren't deadly. They are. They're deadlier than any standard religion. And they have religious zeal. Yahowah examines the genuineness of those who are upright and correct. What does it mean that he is examining? Am I taking a test? No. I know the right answers. I've already given them to Yahowah. It means that Yahowah is observing in the sense he's closely examining. He's carefully considering. He is paying attention to what we are doing for you. Why? Because we're doing what he wants done. But the deceitful, those who are wrong, the religious, the rasha. And rasha is widespread delusion, widespread fraud. When it comes to God and being wrong, which is the opposite of tzedakah, being right, there's only one institution that qualifies, religion. Yeah, there's one that qualifies more than any other religion. The others that qualify to a lesser degree are politics, patriotism, conspiracy, and militarism. That's what Russia is. And the one who is fond of violence. Do you know that when the flood occurred, and the Nephilim were dominant in the land, and the Nephilim actually speaks of those who prostrated themselves, the first Muslims, if you will. You know what God, what word he uses to describe them? He says that they were Hamas. They were violent. What did God do to them? He expunged them from the earth. What do you think God's going to do?
Same
when he returns in less than 10 years from now. You think he's going to change? He's just not going to use water this time. He hates his soul.
Wow.
Yes. You know, I opened Volume 1 of Observation with a statement, hate is a virtue.
Mm-hmm.
It's never been more important for people to recognize that than now. Well, at the time, I thought it was an important insight that I had derived from studying Yah's word. But Dod, my king, wrote it 3,000 years ago. But it's good. If you come to the same conclusion as the smartest man who ever lived, that's not such a bad thing.
Well done.
Yeah. It's God's conclusion as well. Mm-hmm. It's just that we need to know what to hate. Religion, politics, militarism, Hamas, violence, being wrong. And we need to know how to hate. It's not with bullets and bombs. It's not with fists and knives. With words, wielded wisely, the truth. It's important that we understand that on October 7th, there were pedophiles, and we should hate pedophilia. There were rapists, and we should hate rape. There were terrorists, and we should hate terror. There were mass murderers, and we should hate mass murderers. There were those who abducted men, women, and children, and we should hate those who engage in human trafficking and slavery. There are things we should hate, and we should hate the doctrines that inspire people to do these things. Humankind has been mistreated, abused, deceived, and traumatized, particularly Jews, for the past 5,000 years. Well, Jews not for quite that long, but humankind all of that time, and all by civilized man. The more man becomes part of nations and large institutions, the worse he becomes. I've said this many times, that individuals can be good or bad. Most are a little of both. But large institutions and nations are always bad. The larger the group of humans, the worse it becomes. For the past 5,000 years, because far too few people have had the courage or compassion to oppose the religious, political, militaristic, conspiratorial influences that have been so universally corrupting and corrosive, deadly. Unless far more of us learn what and how to hate the caustic influences which have stained every human civilization and bloodied humankind will continue to be as destructive and deadly, as deceitful and damning as Islam is today and has always been from its inception. Terror exists and prevails because there isn't one in a million of us who have invested the time, who has demonstrated the courage, who has embraced the characteristics which Yahowah caused Dode to be inspired with and to write, and who as a result are willing to expose and condemn Islam, the religion responsible for over 95% of today's terrorist atrocities. There isn't one in a million who understands and despises what Paul wrote sufficiently to systematically disavow Christian deceptions, holding the religion accountable for the horrible crimes it has committed against man and God. There isn't one in a million willing to explain why we should not be political or patriotic, providing the reasons to not support a political party, your military, a spy organization, international diplomacy, any conspiracy or religion. Far more people come to their senses, shed their ignorance, develop some character, and start thinking rationally, then deceit and violence will, well, when people shed those things, it will be no more. So long as they cling to them, they will continue to ravage our world, littering every place on earth. For love to prevail, hate must exist. For truth to be known and accepted, lies must be loathed. There are many things that God has identified worthy of our disdain. For us to do as we should, they must be known, understood, exposed, and condemned with all of the words wielded wisely, using evidence and reason. And yet the religious say, well, we should be against homosexuality. God has nothing to say about the subject. Actually, nothing. He's opposed to forcibly coming upon another man sexually, but he's also opposed to a man coming against a woman without consent. He's against incest and pedophilia, rape, bestiality. But this rest of it, no. This idea that women need to be dressed up to their eyeballs and that the relationships between men and women need to be religiously controlled, it's nonsense. God doesn't have any issue with sexuality. What he's got an issue with is lies about him. Hiding his name, removing his name. Not speaking honestly about the conditions and benefits of his covenant. Not speaking openly and honestly about the nature of the seven Moed Mikre and what they represent, invitations to meet with God, to be called out of this world. There are things that matter to God, but prayer is not one of them. He doesn't even want us to pray. He wants us to listen to him instead. Worship is not one of them. He has no interest in being worshipped. Known, respected, loved, yes. Worshipped, no. Doesn't want anyone bowing down to him. He'd never ask for our donations. He hates religion with a passion. It's a very simple relationship that he's offering. A straightforward means to be part of it. Either choose yes, no. If you choose yes, you get to be part of his covenant family forever. Live with him. Live with the rest of us. Experience the universe. If you say no, yeah, your soul simply dissipates to nothing at the end of your life. There's no reward, no penalty. But if you fight against God's people, if you fight against him, if you oppose him, if you're out there parading at a college campus somewhere around the world against Israel, if you're part of a mujahideen, raping and abducting Jews, are encouraging those who do, then your soul is destined for an eternity in Sheol. And so there's a real consequence of what you choose to do in this life, and you need to know it. So we should never promote violence as a solution to any problem. We must use words. Second, we must acknowledge that religion and other forms of deceit live within the souls of their advocates. The treacherous will continue to be corrosive as long as the proponents of such tactics live. This is why Yahweh will be expelling and exterminating them. It's his job to do so. It also means that it is appropriate for us to condemn, using words, the most vocal and notorious proponents of delusions, since Yah clearly holds them in disdain. Beginning with the likes of Paul, Akiba, and Muhammad. The idea of a prison whose bars are comprised of light appears intriguing, especially fitting and proper. He will bring down on those who misled and are mistaken the deceitful and religious, a means of incarceration, comprised of fire and brimstone, in addition to a scorching spirit of righteous indignation, a fitting receptacle and an appropriate fate for them. No, there is no fire in Sheol. But when Yahweh returns, he's going to transform the entire earth into the conditions experienced in the Garden of Eden, where there was no religion, no politics, no militarism. And to do that, he must eliminate all traces of religion and politics. And since the host for religion and politics are the religious and political, they must go. Mm-hmm. And he said he's not going to eliminate people anymore with a flood. So what is he going to do? He's coming back, and his sun is coming back, as brilliant as the sun, as light, as energy. And those who are not protected by the set-apart spirit as members of the covenant will be incinerated. That's going to be very much like fire and brimstone. As a matter of fact, both of the two witnesses, Yada and Elia, in Jerusalem during the last 3.5 years, they're going to have the capacity to incinerate those who are annoying. A little foretaste of what Dod and Yahweh are going to do.
Yeah,
take that. Enough already. You've said way too much. The scorching spirit of righteous indignation, a fitting receptacle, and an appropriate fate for them. Mizmowr 11:6. It has been obvious that Yah despises everything associated with Rasha, which is the closest word in the Hebrew language to religion. Eternal incarceration in a cell comprised of burning sulfur while enduring the righteous indignation of an angry spirit does not sound very appealing. And by the way, there will be a period of time where the worst of the worst are going to be held as hostages here on the earth, because the worst of the worst aren't being dispatched immediately to Sheol. I don't know if you know that or not. We've talked about it on this program.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But there's a whole lot of people who deserve to see those who tormented them get theirs. The mother and father whose fingers and toes and eyes were mutilated by Muslims on October 7th while they had their eyes, were forced to watch their children have their fingers and toes cut off and their eyes gouged out, where these Muslims ate their Shabat dinner and then pissed on them. They deserve to watch those Muslims suffer. And God's going to assure that that happens. And so there are the likes of Muhammad and all of the initial Muslims and many popes and many, many rabbis. And some of the people that I have mentioned, like Paul, like Peter, like Akiba, like Maimonides, like Hadrian, like Titus, like Nero, like Vespasian, who before they get to go to their eternal stay in the black hole of Sheol are going to get what they deserve, and the souls of those they abuse, particularly of God's people, are going to have closure because they were helpless as they were tortured, and now they're going to see them get their own. And so there will be a period where there will be captives held like this on earth before they're sent to Sheol. And Dod and Yahweh are going to delegate the responsibility of making sure there is closure for God's people and that there is justice.
Yeah, very fitting.
That makes you uncomfortable. Then I guess you don't have the same morality that Yahweh does. You can't torment his people and not pay a price.
Right.
Yes, Yahweh despises everything associated with Yasa. So this is the right way to resolve what they have done. By all means, let us avoid being Rasha, misleading or mistaken. Who has done the most damage to mislead God's people? Rabbis.
Rabbis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They will be the first, and they deserve what's coming to them.
Yes, sir.
Let's avoid being Rasha, religious and thus deceitful, corrupted and corrupting, wrong and thus invalid, fraudulent and unethical. Let's be careful and not lead anyone astray, always avoiding that which is inappropriate and confusing in relationship to God. Being Tsadyq right is clearly the better choice. In fact, Rasha is being presented in direct contrast to being Tsadyq. One is wrong, mm-hmm. The other is right. And there is the difference between life and death. Yahweh and Satan. Shamayim, or Sheol. I have the time probably to read this next line. We don't have any time to comment on it. But once we finish with it, I wish you all a wonderful Shabbat. The conclusion of those who have celebrated Chag Matzah. At the later time, we wish you the most wonderful celebration of Chag Matzah. Concerning those who are right and thus vindicated, Yahweh loves the upright and the correct. The straightforward and reasonable shall gaze upon his face. What a wonderful way to conclude this program.
Yeah.
I hope for those listening in Israel, for all of the Yehudim, around the world, particularly in the United States and Europe, become right with God. Become vindicated. Come to know Yahweh's name. Love him, and he will love you. Be right, and he will be right with you. And you shall gaze upon his face. May Yah bless. Good night to one and all. I thank you for listening, and I wish you a wonderful conclusion to Chag Matzah. And the rest of your Shabbat.
Yeah.
Good night.
Shabbat shalom, y'all. Good night.